everyone. I'm Thomas from France. So let's talk about data clean room. So I guess the first question that you all want me to respond is, what is a data clean room? When you talk about data clean room, we talk about a closed and secure environment where marketers will be able to merge their first-party data, either CRM data, offline conversion, online conversion, with the advertising data at the more granular level, which is the log event level. So why we want to do that? It's because it allows us to make granular analysis while respecting the privacy principles. And we are here with the four main principles when we talk about privacy. And the four benefits with data clean room are, first, there is no user data which is exported or viewable ever outside of the platform. Secondly, all the reports are aggregated and we do not have access to raw data. And third, the infrastructure itself relies on the GAFA secure environment. So Google is relying on Google Cloud Platform, and Amazon, for example, is relying on the AWS, so it's really secure. And the first point is that advertiser or media partner will always remain owner of their data. So that allows us to make granular analysis in a really privacy-safe environment. Today, data clean room are becoming a standard for all the major players of digital marketing. So Google have Ads Data Hub. Maybe you already know Ads Data Hub, which make you available all the data of Google, which is Google Analytics, DV360, YouTube. But Amazon have also his own platform, which is Amazon Marketing Cloud Platform. And Meta have also its own, which is Advanced Analytics. So it's really beginning to be a standard, and it's not replacing your own tool. So we talked before about Google Analytics 4. It will not replace it. It's only a new tool where we can do other analysis more granular. So why do we need data clean room? In one sentence, because it will allow us to deliver powerful insight at a user behavior level without cookie. That's all it's about only that, is that we want to be able to do user-level analysis without cookie. And all of that while complying with the latest data privacy and secure standards. Period, I want to say. So what do you want to use this kind of infrastructure? Because it will help us to leverage new technology to help improve your marketing operation on three main axes. The first one is transparency. Thanks to this granularity, we will be able to verify the advertising spend, the advertising cost, and it will bring more transparency on all the supply chain. The second one, it's one of the main important one, is measurement. It will help us to do custom report, especially for attribution report. It will help us to understand better the different attribution. We can bring in the data clean room all the attribution models that are existing. And finally, it will help us to understand our audience. That is the main point. Thanks to this granularity, we will be able to make analysis to understand the user path, the user journey, and to improve our strategy. So how does it work? Basically, it's a data lake. It's more a technology infrastructure that plug-and-play plays. So you will have two types of data, your advertiser data, so Google, Amazon, or Facebook data, and the first-party data. So we will match it inside of the platform at a really granular level, and we will have able all those data with a limit of 100 users, so it's a way to ensure the privacy of the data. So basically, in this data lake, you will be able to do SQL-based requests in order to do custom measurement and improve the analysis to understand your audience. Who can be able to use a data clean room? It's not a plug-and-play platform, which means it's not a new tool for marketers. It's more a tool for data scientists, because you need to understand SQL requests. You need to have some basis of statistics. So basically, what we do with our client is both
When clients have a data science skill set in their company, we help them to understand the platform, to develop the use case. But we know that not everyone can have those type of capability in their company. So we also develop use cases. We have templatized more than 15 analyses that we can do with you, with your company, in order to be able to empower the platform. So now I guess the final question is, but what can we do with that? Why is it useful? So I just wanted to bring some example. The first one, which is an example that we made with a client on Amazon, which have a lot of different strategy on Amazon, keyword acquisition, et cetera. And we use the data clean room to understand the relation of all those different campaign. And it helped us to understand that some overlap was really good. For example, here we had a good overlap with the acquisition on keyword campaign, which is empowering and improving the ROS. But some other was destroying value. And we identified through this analysis that make us able to make sure that we are not making those overlap again. Another example for a client here on the DV, we use the granularity of the platform in order to identify the best capping and the best reach and frequency in order to optimize the acquisition strategy. So here's the best frequency was 5, and it helped us to be sure that we was not saturating the audience. So if we wanted to resume what is a data clean room, and just to finish with 4 main messages, the first one is that it's a secured environment, securely safe environment to do custom analysis. The second one is that there is no data outside of the platform, never. And it's not a plug-and-play business intelligence tool. It's really more a data warehouse where we need a data science skill set in order to do it. And finally, and it's something that we are convinced at Jellyfish, we really think that first-party data will underpin the future of marketing. So we need this kind of tool to be able to unlock the potential of our marketing strategy by understanding at the more granular way our user. And I will let now the stage to Meg to talk a bit more about first party use cases.
Thanks, Thomas. And I'm going to take Francois's lead and apologize for my accent, because I'm an Aussie and we tend to drop vowels. So I'll do my best. But obviously, some of the themes that have emerged today are obviously that first-party data is more important than ever before. As the third-party identifiers that we rely on continue to decline, we have to turn to solutions that are both privacy-first and respect user privacy, but also cookie-less. And so I want to talk about 2 very simple examples and perhaps very quick wins that you can have within the Google ecosystem today. And I'm going to talk about these 2 solutions one by one. The first is enhanced conversions, which essentially, in a nutshell, it allows us to use your first-party consented data to recover conversions that are lost to browser changes. That's in its simplest form. We'll talk about how that works and how you can get started. The other is customer match, which uses your first-party data again for more effective personalization, targeting more effective ads personalization and site personalization. So these are the 2 solutions. We're going to look at them one by one. But for those who are not yet in a position to be able to activate their first-party data, I want to give some top tips on how you can, I guess, maximize the opportunity within your organization and organize yourselves around activating first-party data. At Google, I work with some of our largest fashion e-com retailers who are, on one hand, some of our most sophisticated retailers, but in other ways, they still struggle with these things as well. And so hopefully I'll be able to share some tips and with some of the things that I've learned working with these customers today. So let's look at enhanced conversions first. We know that the tools that we rely on for digital marketing today, for bidding and optimization and attribution and measurement, rely on us to observe conversions and understand the ad events that preceded those conversions. When that link dies with third-party identifiers, it has a significant downstream impact on the power and reliability of these tools. And that's essentially what we want to solve for with enhanced conversions. In its simplest form, if we look at how enhanced conversions works, if a user views your ad on YouTube, they go through to your site to convert, but the browser has blocked that cookie, so our bidders can't see that that ad event was what led to that conversion. If you have enhanced conversions implemented, that conversion tag will essentially securely hash the user data that you specify and send that back to Google's servers, where we can match that with Google's signed-in consented user data in a hashed, privacy-safe way, recover that conversion, record it in your account, and that's what powers our bidding algorithms more effectively. It's one of the quickest wins that our customers can implement today. I think we've got very high adoption, I think, amongst my clients, but I think there are a lot of customers that could get a very, very quick win away today. So if you're going to write down one little action item from my 10-minute section here, it's to speak to your Jellyfish account director about enhanced conversions and how to get started. If you want to look in the meantime, you can also go to our help centres at support.google.com and search for enhanced conversions. We know that it works as well. We see about a 5% median conversion rate lift on search, which kind of makes sense that it's a bit lower than YouTube because it's mostly click-based. But we still lose a lot of that click-based data because first-party cookies have a shorter shelf life, as we know. On YouTube, we see a much greater impact. So for video action campaigns, we see about a 17% conversion lift on average, which is pretty powerful. So yes, action one for today. Talk to your Jellyfish account director about enhanced conversions. Customer match, we'll also briefly touch on. So customer match is essentially matching your CRM data with Google's signed-in user base, so you can target those customers online. What you know about your customers is more powerful than anything Google can tell you about your customers. If you're able to adjust your media to focus on your highest value customers, you'll get a lot more bang for your buck. And the more you know about the customers, the more timely and relevant your advertising can be. And these are the things that will drive both performance, but also the consumer experience that they're having with your brand. In its simplest form, again, we match your CRM database with the Google signed-in universe so that you can identify your best customers online. You can exclude or target them in your ads campaigns. And you can also tailor your bids, the message that you're sending those customers, and even the landing page to really improve the customer experience. But it doesn't need to be as complex. You don't need to manage the end-to-end. I hate this term, you know, we really want to, you know, manage the end-to-end customer journey. That's really complex to do. There's a lot of really simple ways that you can improve customer experience and improve performance. So some of the typical use cases, prospecting in the first instance. If you can exclude your existing customers from your prospecting campaigns, that's going to be a more effective spend overall. If you can use that data to inform similar audiences and find customers that look like your existing customers, again, it's a more efficient prospecting buy. It's a very, very simple, quick win. Another potential action item if you're not already doing this today. And then if you want to go deeper, you can look at how you can grow that connection with your customers further by cross-selling, upselling, thinking about your retention and loyalty strategies and how you can tailor your messaging according to those strategies. Customer match is very scalable. We have at Google over 7 platforms with over 1 billion signed in monthly users. So it's a very scalable product. You can reach those customers across search, shopping, YouTube, display, and Gmail. And there are 5 different identifiers that we can use. Obviously, the cleaner your database, the fresher your database, and the more signals you have about your customers, the more of these 5 identifiers, the better match rate, the better the match rate is going to be. But also your Jellyfish account director and your Google team can help you to make the most of customer match to really ensure that your match rates are as high as they can be. There's a lot of best practice that we can provide to help you make the most of it. And again, just like enhanced conversions, it's a no-brainer to be doing customer match today. If we compare customer match audiences to search non-audience traffic, if you like, we see a really significant lift in conversion rate and click-through rate. So the information you have about your customers, we know feeds our bidders with the most valuable data we can give them. Similarly, if you're finding similar audiences, we see a really similar lift there in conversion and click-through rate. With my customers today, my top tip is to take, if you have your CRM database there, you usually have your customers segmented in a way that's meaningful to you. Your high, medium, low lifetime value, you might have product or category interest segments. My top tip is if you're running automated bidding, which I'm hoping in the room, a lot of us are running automated bidding, apply all of your customer segments to all of your automated bidding campaigns and watch the performance lift that you see. It's a very simple step. to start leveraging your first-party data without a very complex structure. Our automated bidding algorithms will understand that you've segmented the customers into a way that's meaningful to you, and it will start to cross-reference those signals with Google's proprietary signals to power automated bidding in a more effective way. Tip number two, if you're taking notes. And again, obviously, if your customer data is being used, we've talked a lot today about how important security and privacy are. And Google, your data is going to be kept with the same level of confidence using the same industry standards that Google, the same industry-leading standards that Google uses to protect its own data. We're also always working to ensure that our products stay compliant with all of the industry-leading standards for information security. And you also have full transparency and control into how your data is being used. We fully document our policies around the use of this data, you have a lot of transparency and control into how that data is being used. It's only ever matched with Google users, and you have control over how that data is being used. Google isn't using that data on your behalf. So again, if you have your first-party data ready to activate, there's some of my top tips. Apply all customer segments to all automated bidding campaigns and observe the uplift. Get enhanced conversions in place. if there's one thing, I'd prioritize that first, actually. But enhanced conversions is a really important one. But if you're in a situation where you have certain technical or organizational blockers where activating first-party data becomes impossible, here are the three things that I kind of recommend. One is you need senior level sponsorship of your data strategy. You need your senior level stakeholders to understand how important this will be to the future of your marketing and how important it will be to differentiating in the future. So making sure you have that senior level alignment will ensure that those silos can be broken down between legal, between CRM teams, between marketing teams, and between the IT teams. The other thing is don't over-engineer. Tip two, don't over-engineer it. You don't need, before you go and spend £1 million on a CDP, spend £1 million on a CDP, they're great, but before you do that, you don't need to do that. You can actually just look for small tests to prove the value of your data and then look to scale from there. I've seen a number of times clients spend a couple of years and £1 million putting in a CDP to then only at the other end of it activate a few simple use cases that they could have activated with the existing tools that they already had. And then the third is having a cross-functional task force. So once you have that senior stakeholder buy-in and alignment, and someone is making sure that everyone's moving in the same direction and they're breaking down those silos, having shared KPIs around activating that data, understanding what do we want to get out of it, how are we going to approach it, and how are we going to incentivize these teams to ensure that we can activate these and get these things off the ground. The other thing you might find as a blocker is kind of the skill sets that you have in-house, and that's where renting skill sets from partners like Jellyfish can enable you to scale quickly and get these projects off the ground. So that's the end of my section. I hope that was helpful. And I think I'm now going to be handing over to Iggy from Meta.